I made my own in-game level editor to help me build the open world that I want for my role-playing game. This allows me to paint the world as one large canvas rather than individual scenes. But more importantly, it will allow you as the player to build your own dungeons and upload them for others to play. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor, where I post weekly devlogs for my game Zoe and a cursed dreamer. If you've been watching the devlogs and or streams so far, then you know that I'm currently working up to adding the first dungeon into my game. I've been designing enemies, drawing concept art for the environment, and even creating my own lighting system. One of the final steps that remains is to build the actual dungeon itself. So I needed a tool that would make this easier for me, and I want to do this early on in development because it could define the layout for my worlds and dungeons. Up until this point, I've had standalone scenes that transition between each other when you trigger an area. There's nothing wrong with this, it works great for many games, but I want to create an overworld that feels like one single cohesive thing. There are a lot of little issues that stand in the way, however. The main ones being the how to build such a world, and how to load it in for the player. I can't create one gigantic map that contains the entire world. This would be ridiculous to both develop and load into the game, so I need to break the world up into chunks that dynamically load around the player as they explore it. Originally, I developed this chunk-based system inside of Godot with the use of tool scripts. If you're not aware of what tool scripts are, then they allow you to modify the node's behavior in the editor while you're building the game. Tile map and tile set scripts are especially powerful because you can use them to modify how tiles are placed in the editor. For example, I created a tile set script that uses the method forward subtile selection, which the documentation tells you absolutely nothing about, and I've never seen a tutorial that uses it. But it gets called before setting a tile, and lets you modify the auto tile chords it's used. I use this to make the auto tile bind to the edges of the chunk so that when I place them next to each other, they will tile up seamlessly. Without this script, I would have needed to do this manually by disabling the auto tile. This can be cumbersome to do, and an absolute nightmare to modify later. With this script, I was able to attach it to my tile maps and start building levels inside of the Godot editor. But I soon noticed myself doing something that I really wanted to avoid, which is building areas for the sake of filling space. For the upcoming demo, I want the player to travel a little ways from the town and into a dungeon, so my main focus was filling up several chunks rather than thinking about how this might feel from the player's perspective. Once I zoomed in, I realized that the path I made felt much longer than I had expected it to be. I believe the reason for this was because I was restricted to individual cells. I could only work with one scene at a time, so my mind was focused on how to fill up that individual scene so that I could move on to the next one. What I would rather do would be to have a large canvas that I can draw the world onto like a painting. So I decided to go ahead and start developing my own level editor. Building this would give me a lot of advantages, such as custom brush sizes when placing tiles, hotkeys for quickly selecting the tile that I'm using, and just having everything be one large canvas rather than individual cells. The different brush sizes is probably the feature that I wanted most out of this. In Godot, you can only place one single tile at a time. If this were pixel art, it would be the equivalent of drawing a large image one pixel at a time. I actually build my scenes with a pen and tablet, much like I do my pixel art, so having large brush sizes is a massive time saver. I did this by creating an array of Boolean values, which I iterate through when I set a tile. This is very much hacked together, and limits me to the sizes that I manually specify, but it's all I need right now, and it only took me a couple of minutes to implement, so I'm not going to complain about it. I also added the ability to toggle the eraser by pressing the E on my keyboard, so that it removes the tile on the tile map that I'm currently working on, or it places a grass tile if I'm working on the ground layer. In Godot, you need to use the mouse's right click to remove a tile, which as you can imagine makes this very difficult with a tablet, and I probably erase more than I draw, so this was a much desired feature as well. As for the level editor's UI, it's extremely basic at the moment. I click a button, and it selects the current tile to be used when building the level. This is mostly what I need to develop the levels currently, so there's not much need to make it more complicated than this. However, when you'll have access to this tool in the full release, I would like to make it a lot more polished. I'm a big fan of level editors in games. RPG Maker was my favorite game for PlayStation, and was technically my first introduction into game development. And Little Big Planet is up there among my all-time favorite games, simply because I love playing with the level editor. So this is something that I'm very much looking forward to polishing up for y'all to play around with in the full release. Not only so that y'all can develop levels for each other to play, but so that I can play them as well. Making your dream game is great and all, but since I'm designing and developing it, I'm going to know everything about it. What I'm really looking forward to is playing the things that y'all create that will be new and exciting to me. As for how I'm setting the tiles that the level editor needs to use, I created some buttons with custom scripts on them that let me to specify the name of the tile map and tile to use. Whenever you click the button, it emits a signal that the level editor listens for and saves that data to be used whenever you click the environment. As you can see, I'm using a string on the buttons to define which tile map I want to use, which means I need to be able to use that string to get the tile map that I want. To do this, I'm storing all of my tile maps together into a dictionary, which allows me to assign them string values that I can use to find the tile map that I want. It also allows me to iterate through the dictionary to access each individual tile map, which is how I'm accessing the data for the individual chunks. I needed to break the tile map into pieces rather than loading it as one massive thing and having it be a resource hog. I then need to unload to each section when they're no longer needed. The first thing you need to do to load chunks that are near you is to determine which chunk you're currently in. All of my chunks are the same size. This is fine for now because I don't have transitions where the camera moves from one scene to the next. I haven't ruled this out either though. I'm waiting to see how this implementation of the open world feels first. The plus side of having screen transitions is that it helps the player make a mental map of the world by noting where the transitions happen. This is my first time attempting to build a world like this, so I'm still experimenting and learning. Since all of my chunks are the same size, all I need to do to find the current chunk is to divide the position I want by the dimensions of the chunk and take the floor of that. It's important to take the floor value as opposed to the integer value, because the floor will round down negative values, which is needed for the chunks that are less than zero. Once I have the current chunk, I then need to use that to load it and the nearby chunks. This is useful for the level editor, as it allows me to see the surrounding area when building the world, but it'll also be useful in-game for loading chunks around the player as they navigate the world. As the active chunk changes, it needs to load in new chunks around itself and unload old chunks that are no longer needed. To do this, I have an array that keeps track of the chunks that are currently loaded. Whenever I set the active chunk, it will add all the chunks around it to the list if they're not already in it. This is needed because as you move from one chunk to the next, some of the chunks that are already loaded don't need to be loaded again. This handles the loading, but I also need to clean up after myself by unloading the chunks that are no longer needed. As I'm loading the chunks, I also create an array that lists the nearby chunks, so everything else in the loaded chunks array can be unloaded. With this settled, there's still one massive glaring problem that y'all probably haven't noticed because I kind of fixed it at the last second of writing this script. Whenever we change chunks, the game hangs up while it loads and unloads the tile map. This is because it takes time to iterate through all the loops as it either sets or unsets the tile map. My first thought to fixing this was to use a thread to apply these changes. However, the active scene is not thread safe, so attempting to manipulate this can lead to some sudden crashes without warning or errors. A few possibilities came to mind to deal with this. Worst case scenario, I can use a thread to add all new tile sets like the one I used in the environment. I've already tested this so far and it seems to work, apart from some sketchy flickering. Though I haven't tested this extensively, so who knows. The trouble with this is that there's now a whole bunch of tile maps to manage rather than the one set that I've been using so far. Another possibility is to gradually load and unload the tile sets a little bit at a time inside of the main loop. And as of writing this sentence, I just tested a method where I reduced the chunk size to be a lot smaller so that I can queue the chunks to be loaded and unloaded in the process method and then abort it when it starts taking too long, but pick it back up where it left off in the next process method. So far, this method seems to work well enough, but it will need more testing. I post a new devlog every Saturday and livestream every Tuesday, so if you're new, then join the sub club to get notified for future videos. There's a playlist that will catch you up on everything I've done so far, and I will see you there.